Good morning, everybody, and welcome to NIDA, and thanks for joining us for our 2016 Open Day. My name is Alastair Graham, and I'm the Director of Business Development here at NIDA. And of course, there are many things going on across the NIDA campus today for Open Day, which includes talks about all the courses we offer, so short courses, diplomas, bachelor and master's degrees across all disciplines, as well as demonstrations and displays of student work. And you can also participate in an open class or join a backstage tour and take a look at our excellent facilities that we have here. There's a number of sessions in this theatre today, mainly focusing on our Bachelor of Fine Arts in Acting, but also the Diploma of Stage and Screen Performance and Diploma of Musical Theatre. So please refer to the schedule events, which you should already have, for the session times. Also, if you're interested, there's a book sale up in the library, and the Student Council are doing a bake sale out in the foyer, which is very important. And if you want to see the upcoming NIDA student production called The Olympians in this theatre, which is a great example of what we do at NIDA, you can buy tickets for just $18 today from the box office out in the foyer also. So everything is listed, as I mentioned, in the schedule of events. Now, just a couple of quick housekeeping things I'm obliged to tell you before we get underway. As you may have seen on the door as you came in, we are recording today's session and it's being live streamed. So there's a chance you may be filmed or photographed, particularly if you're asking a question later on. Now, the recording and images will be used in the future for NIDA's promotion on the website. If you prefer not to be filmed or photographed, please let Anna know. She's down the front there, and we can find a seat for you up to the back, up towards the back. And if you have any questions throughout the live stream today, feel free to use the hashtag NIDA Open Day on Twitter, and our Twitter handle is NIDA Community. All right, so let's get into it. So first up, we have Tricia Ryan, who's the head of our Open program, and she'll talk to you about everything we do through those courses. Thank you.
Good morning. Welcome to Open Day. As Alastair said, my name is Tricia Ryan, and I'm the head of NIDA Open. NIDA Open is NIDA's short course or open access program. And it's comprised of a team of extraordinary teaching artists and educational professionals who design and deliver open access programs for anyone who wants to experience NIDA. Now, a lot of what you're going to hear today at Open Day will be about how you can prepare for future full-time training here at NIDA. But I'm going to talk to you about how you can start your training with NIDA now through a NIDA Open course. And the images that I have rolling behind me here are pictures from some of these courses, most of them from the last 6 months and our most recent holiday program. We use many of the same tutors and resources as the full-time degree or vocational studies courses to create training experiences that relate to people from all different backgrounds and varying levels of experience. And we do work with everyone. Here on a Sunday morning, our 2 to 3 year olds with their parents are in our creative play classes. We work with mid-career professionals who are looking to retrain in a new discipline or brush up some of their existing skills. And we also work with emerging artists who are looking for pre-professional training before they might go into full-time study or commence a career. We offer courses in nearly everything, obviously acting, but also design, directing, writing, filmmaking, makeup. We even offer NIDA audition preparation courses. So if you are interested to audition for a higher education course at the end of this year, then that might be something for you. These courses are offered in most locations around the country. We're in Sydney, Melbourne and Brisbane on a regular basis, and then through most major capital cities and regional centres throughout the year. The youth term and adult short course programs run on weekends and evenings and on weekdays during the holidays. And courses are anything from 1 day up to 8 weeks in duration. So there really is something for everyone. Now, in addition to all of the short course programs, we also offer a part-time 6 or 12 month intensive program across a variety of disciplines called NIDA Studios. Our studio courses run on weekends and are designed for young people aged 15 to 18, or adults 18 plus. We do keep those cohorts separate. And it's for people who want a rigorous approach to training but may not be ready for full-time training yet. And that could be for a number of reasons. Maybe you've just left high school and are looking to develop some skills further before you move into full-time training. Or maybe personal and time commitments mean that you can't commit to full-time training right now. And for any of those reasons, NIDA Studios could be a training option for you. Our studio courses are offered in Brisbane, Melbourne and Sydney, and there are 2 intakes for studios each year, Registration for our July intake is now open, and auditions and interviews for July courses will be in June. So if you're interested to join the studio in mid-year intake, do speak to us today or get in contact with us soon to talk about the interview and audition process. Now, I do suspect many of you here today and those of you watching online will be currently enrolled in secondary education. Can I just get a show of hands who is at high school at the moment in grade 11 or 12? Excellent, thank you, welcome. We offer a number of courses that are designed for senior secondary students specifically. And not all of those courses you need to attend with your school. Some of them you can enrol as an individual student. But we do, of course, offer a number of courses for school groups or teachers. Some of the school courses that we have on offer include devising and play building demonstration for secondary school students. That usually operates in the first term of the year, so if you're in year 11 now, that could be something to look at for next year. In primary school, we offer improvisation and a play building demonstration for primary school students, and that is actually happening here at Kensington next week in Sydney. Back with the high school students again, our individual project study day for New South Wales HSC students will occur in October, and there is some more information about that out in the foyer. And our newest experience, which is an alternate reality transmedia theatre game for primary school grade 5 and 6 students called Story Trader. And we're particularly excited about the Story Trader program. It's been a long time in the making, and it's a wonderful way to teach storytelling and creative agency to grade 5 and 6 students. So if you are a teacher that works with those age groups, do get in contact with us so we can talk about how that can operate in your classroom. So there's a lot of planned courses, and if none of those fit, we do also offer customised courses. And we customise courses for individuals, for school groups, for community groups. Anyone can contact us to design a training program to support teacher professional development, individual development, school curriculum, or any community interest. So there's a lot of options. Short courses of 1 to 8 weeks, 1 day to 8 weeks. Studios, we have a residency program that I haven't spoken much about, but that might be of interest to adults looking for an extended stay here at NIDA. School programs, some that are designed specifically for school groups and some for students. The options can seem a little bit overwhelming when you're trying to work out how to start your creative education. So the advice is to speak to us. We are out in the foyer today. If you're not here at Kensington today, all of our courses are listed online and the website is open.nida.edu.au. So there is a full comprehensive listing. There is a page dedicated to schools and there is also some information about how to design a customised program. Or you can call us. It's Sydney Eastern Standard Time, 9 a.m. till 5 p.m. Monday to Friday, and we would love to talk to you about how we can develop an open access program for you. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much, Tricia. Because we have an advertised schedule and we're streaming live, we do need to stick to the schedule. So the next session will start at 11:30 and that'll be about the Diploma of Stage and Screen Performance. So if you'd just like to hang around till then, we'll be back with you shortly. Thank you. Good morning, everybody, and welcome to NIDA's Open Day. Thank you for joining us. Next up on the program, we have Mark Gaal, who's the director of our vocational studies area, talking about the Diploma of Stage and Screen Performance. So please welcome Mark.
Good morning, everyone, and thank you for coming along. As Alastair has just mentioned, I'm here to talk to you about the Diploma of Stage and Screen Performance. Now, this is a new course for us, so I imagine there might be some questions at some point that you'd like to ask, because there's no history of this course being at NIDA. Basically, a couple of years ago, we did some research. We met with industry representatives. We also met with different community groups, and we said, look, NIDA's been providing terrific courses for a many number of decades. Is there anything you think that we should add to what we offer prospective students? And a couple of things emerged, and this particular course aims to address some of what we consider to be the industry gaps in training. It's also, in all honesty, this course an opportunity to allow school leavers to explore what options there are in the live and recorded arts. So we have called this course a Diploma of Stage and Screen Performance because, first and foremost, it does formally develop skills related to performing live in a theatre such as this and also to camera. And we know that there's a lot of interest for young people in exploring those areas. We also look at some other key areas, which are the ones that industry bodies said we needed to address, which is one of collaboration, how people work together, collaborate together to create new material, which actually in itself is a very crucial element to examine formally, because unlike some of the other art forms out there, the one of creating and being in and delivering performance is always collaborative. So, you know, if you want to be a painter, things are very, very private and personal. You can do that by yourself. If you want to be a writer, it can be initially a very private, thing to do. But with performance, it's always collaborative. You're always working with other performers, with directors, designers, technicians, camera crew. So we wanted to formally investigate how people would do that best, how they would collaborate. So that's all a part of the course as well. The course, being a diploma course, is 1 year, the better part of 1 year in duration. And it also introduces students to a whole range of different roles that exist within the live and recorded arts. Now, this means that sometimes people finish school, they go, you know what, I love everything to do with acting and performance, but sometimes school leavers aren't aware of all the career opportunities and possibilities that are out there. So as well as this focus on performance and collaboration and creating new works for both stage and screen, there's also an element to it that is about showing people the range of possibilities that lie ahead. Because whatever the fashion in terms of film and TV and theatre, we know that the live and the recorded arts are always with us. There's always storytelling as such a fundamental, you know, human endeavour. You know, there's always a hunger for stories. People always love to be in them. So we know that it's around, it's been around, it's going to continue to be around, and we want to really arm school leavers who take this course and then become graduates of this course with a real sense of awareness and knowledge and skill in what else is out there for them. Because let's face it, if you're really interested in these areas, you learn for many, many years, and you develop your skills over many years. And it's kind of something that you grow and allow yourself to grow into through jobs and through training. So that's a bit of a snapshot of the of this new course. We have put up a few details on our website, which might give you more information, but our first intake will be in 2017. So we will be holding interviews and auditions towards the end of this year, and then the course commences in 2017. This particular diploma we won't be delivering at this campus. So if you're interested, have a look at our website as to where we're delivering it. We have a wonderful partnership with Western Sydney University, and they are making available to us some extraordinary facilities that they have in Penrith. So I don't know if you know that part of Sydney, if you know the campuses that exist out there for Western Sydney Uni, but they have some fantastic facilities that were purpose-built for performance and are now going to be reinvigorated with this course. Because for those of you that are a little older, you might remember that many, many years ago in Penrith, there used to be a course for the performing arts, but that closed down some years ago. So Western Sydney Uni and NIDA have had these great discussions where we've said we want to make use of the space. We know we've got a course that people will value and benefit from, so that's where we'll be delivering that one next year. We're also offering this course in Melbourne. NIDA already has a strong presence in Melbourne with its short course programs and corporate training, and this will be one of the full-time accredited courses that NIDA is going to be offering in Melbourne next year. So they are the two venues really, in Penrith and in Melbourne. Now, if you have any specific questions about this course, please save them up, because I do believe that at the end of the morning, I know I'll be back, and I believe there is a Q&A session for people who have specific questions. But as I said, please look at our website. There's more details there. And if you would like to talk to us about the course, just call up any time. My name is Mark, and I think I'm the only Mark in the building. So if I'm not available when you call, either I or one of my team can get back to you to give you more information on the course. We're really excited by it, as I say. We have such a strong tradition in the courses that we offer. Particularly NIDA is so well known for our acting courses. So I think the addition of this new diploma level course is something we're very excited about. We've been planning it for some time. As I say, the key difference is between this and the 3-year Bachelor of Fine Arts Acting is that is, of course, a longer, more intensive, therefore greater depth of study over 3 years. This is a 1-year diploma course. But for some people, that's enough for them to go, I've got skills to move forward in the profession. And for other people, it really is the beginning of a journey, and you may then decide to do more study here or elsewhere. So that really is one of the points of the course as well. How many of you, I'm just curious to know, how many of you will have specific questions at the Q&A? Can I get a show of hands? Is anyone curious about any other details of this course? Few hands, good. Well, as I say, do come back to the Q&A, otherwise give us a ring, or you can also email us, and there's information on the website. But thank you very much for coming to this talk. The next talk that I'm involved in starts in a few minutes, and it's another one of our vocational studies courses here at NIDA. It's the Diploma of Musical Theatre, so also a diploma course, and that one also runs for the better part of a year. So you can see that NIDA has expanded. We have expanded our course offerings in recent years. Traditionally, we've had a lot of 3-year courses, and because of industry response, we've decided to add a couple of year-long training programs, fully accredited training programs. These are the diploma courses, and some of you will know that we've also added some new master's courses, postgraduate courses. So NIDA's offering a little bit more at the moment than maybe we did 5 or so years ago. So it's fantastic to see you all here. Thank you for coming. As I say, in a few minutes, I'll be talking about the Diploma of Musical Theatre. We'll in fact be doing a performance for those of you who would like to see some of our diploma students singing and acting and moving a bit. We're going to be performing it right here in this space, where we're doing a song for you, and then we're going to talk about the Diploma of Musical Theatre. So I look forward to seeing you about the building and to hearing your questions if you decide to come back later. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Mark. As mentioned, the next session coming up is at 11:45, which is in 4 minutes, where Mark will be talking about the Diploma of Musical Theatre. So we'll catch up with you then. Thank you. to NIDA's Open Day. Thank you for joining us. My name is Alistair Graham, the Director of Business Development here. As there's a few of you who have just joined us for this session, I just do need to remind you that this session is being recorded and photographed, which will be used for promotional purposes at a future date. If you don't want to be filmed or photographed, I'll just need to ask you to move towards the back of the auditorium. Thank you. So next we have the Diploma of Musical Theatre, and Mark Gaal, who's Director of Vocational Studies, is going to talk to you about that. That will run until around 12, and then we'll get into the Bachelor of Fine Arts in Acting talk. Thank you.
We thought we'd be casual this time. Hello again. Those of you that were here before, I'm Mark Gaal, the Director of Vocational Studies, and this is Blake, and we're here to talk about the Diploma of Musical Theatre, which is one of the courses that sits under our Vocational Studies banner. So welcome back. And we're going to very soon, we're going to invite to the stage some of the current students who are going to sing and perform a number for you. So we'll do that. That just gives you a little bit of an insight as to who comes along to do the course and some of the material that they look at. We'll have an opportunity perhaps within this 15 minutes to ask to hear from you if you have any questions about the course. But a very quick overview of what the course is. As we say in the caption here, it's a practical year of study that really focuses on the three elements that are important to a musical theatre performer. We develop the skills of singing, dancing, and acting. We were asked by the industry to provide such a course because we have a terrific musical theatre elective within our three-year Bachelor of Fine Arts program. But in addition to that, there are lots of talented performers who already know that they want to do musical theatre. They've been singing and dancing since a certain age, and they want a dedicated year of study to progress their skills. And this course does just that. As I say, over a year, an intensive year of advancing singing, dancing, and acting. But what we might do first is actually introduce the... can I introduce, please, Anne-Marie McDonald, who is musical director and is going to be playing for us. And I might introduce the students. We might introduce the students to you after the performance, but we might actually have them do their piece for you. It is a piece by Stephen Sondheim. It is called Bit by Bit, Putting It Together. Make them welcome.
Bit by bit, putting it together. Piece by piece, only way to make a work of art. Every moment makes a contribution. Every little detail plays a part. Having just a vision's no solution. Everything depends on execution. Putting it together, that's what counts.
Ounce by ounce, putting it together. Small amounts, adding up to make a work of art. First of all, you need a good foundation. Otherwise, it's risky from the start. Takes a lot of earnest conversation.
But without the proper preparation.
Having just the vision's no solution.
Everything depends on execution.
The art of making art is putting it together. Bit by bit.
By note, working on projection. Lips, teeth, throat, looking for a moment to inhale. Keeping the emotional connection, even when your fellow actors fail. And pointing up the subtext by inflection.
Helping your director reach perfection.
Even though you have a strong objection to the way he's handling the direction.
Art isn't easy. Every minor detail is a major decision. Have to keep things in scale. Have to hold to your vision.
Even though you're feeling apprehensive that you're looking bland and inoffensive.
And you wish your wardrobe was extensive.
Don't forget that spangles are expensive.
the light, Ralph. A little to the right, Ralph. It isn't very bright, Ralph. And must it be so tight, Ralph? Thank you. He does that every night.
Beat by beat, losing inhibition. Head, hands, feet, trying to relax but not too much. Trying to lay out the exposition but without exposing it as such.
Trying to perform but not audition. Trying to establish recognition. Trying to persuade the electrician that he should destroy the competition. Art isn't easy.
Every word, every line, every glance, every movement you improve and refine, then refine each improvement. Bit by bit, putting it together. Piece by piece, working out the vision night and day. What it takes is time and perseverance, dealing with details along the way.
Dealing with producers' interference.
Waiting for the author's disappearance.
Filling up the holes with animation.
Covering the flaws in the construction.
Lacking any scenic ostentation.
This is not a Macintosh production.
Working for a tiny compensation. Hoping for a thunderous ovation. The art of making art is putting it together. Bit by bit, part by part, fit by fit, start by start, stride by stride, kick by kick, glide by glide, stick by stick, side by side by side by side by side by side. And that is the state of the art.
Thank you. Introduce yourselves.
Hi, I'm Blake.
And you don't need the microphone.
Oh, no, we got these.
Still yeah. This is Manon.
Brandon.
Brittany.
Charlie.
And Anne-Marie at the piano. Woo! So, ladies and gentlemen, we only have a few minutes to talk to you about our course, the Diploma of Musical Theatre. But it's exactly what it says it is. As I say, singing, dancing and acting, we give the students very intensive classes. It's a full-time course, the better part of a year. And for some people, it is then enough to progress into the profession. And for other people, it's maybe a pathway to further study. I think people take from a course such as this different things, but we already look for people who have a very advanced skill set, and we take that even further. When we first offered the Diploma of Musical Theatre last year, people said, well, what distinguishes NIDA's Diploma of Musical Theatre from any other? And I suppose, in part, it's this very strong reputation that NIDA has for acting. And we make sure that the students have a very considered and multifaceted approach to the acting side of singing, dancing and acting. So that's the course in a snapshot. I'm wondering if at this juncture, if there's anything that is burning in your minds about the course. Is there anything you would like to ask? If you have a question, please come down to the microphone just at the bottom of the auditorium area there, and you can ask a question, and then either myself, the students, or even Anne-Marie can answer it for you. So, yes, Anna is there to welcome you. Does anyone have any questions about our Diploma of Musical Theatre? Good, someone is coming to the microphone. Hello, what is your name, please?
Hi, my name's Shimon.
Hello, Shimon, welcome.
Thank you. How much dance is also throughout this course, like tap, ballet, jazz?
We do all of those three. We actually do a lot of it. And in term two, we increase our dance classes. We do about 12 hours a week.
Yeah.
Plus
yeah.
Hip-hop and acro in term two.
A bit of Latin here and there
bit
too.
Of Latin.
Yeah.
Yeah.
A lot of dancing. And it did increase this term. And we're also looking at storytelling and putting that into dance as well. Yeah. So, yeah.
And good performance, guys.
Shimon, also about the dance is that some people wonder, do I have to arrive at NIDA expert in dance, expert in singing, expert in acting? And in truth, it has to be said that our students this year do have different levels of dance ability. But what we do is for the first teaching block is that we divide the students into two groups so that we can bring them up to speed. And then by the second teaching block, they're combined. So if musical theatre is your area of interest and you feel, oh, you know, I'm not the best dancer, do take lessons, do keep working at it and get it as good as you can. But there is room within the training for us to, you know, bring you up to speed a bit. Go for it.
Beginner dancers and more advanced dancers, is it with the particular classes, like, say, there's a really good ballet dancer, but she's not that solid in tap. Is it divided that?
The groups aren't fixed at all. Yeah. So actually a couple of us have managed to go from advanced to... I mean, from the beginning to advanced. Hopefully not the other way around.
Speak for yourself.
Yeah, it's very, very adaptable.
Yeah, it's discipline specific. So you might have done some ballet throughout school, you might have a bit of ballet technique, but you might never have done hip hop or something, and you might be in the less skilled hip hop group but in the advanced ballet, or vice versa. So we really do respond to, you know, what we think is the best way to move students forward. Okay. Thanks, Shimon.
Thank you very much.
I'm Karen. I've got two quick questions. One, does this diploma course give students any advanced standing towards your further courses? And secondly, is there any chance that you'll do this at UWS as well?
Thank you for that. Look, it's not out of the... Just to answer your last question first, it's not out of the question that in time we may expand our offerings in Western Sydney, certainly for next year. As I said to those of you that were here earlier, our new Diploma of Stage and Screen Performance will be delivered in Penrith at the Western Sydney University campus. Now, in terms of a pathway, this course leading into other NIDA courses, we offered it for the first time last year, and it certainly that was the case for one of our students who decided that she wanted to do, after the diploma course, more training at NIDA and has auditioned and been accepted and is now training in the Bachelor of Fine Arts program. We always wanted this course to do two things. One, be a possible pathway into other training, so yes, and I do think if you've studied somewhere for a period of time, you are at an advantage to knowing the staff, the students, the facilities, and knowing whether that's right for you as much as anything else. So it does assist you in that way. But as I say, for some students, they really just want a year of intensive skills development to then go and make their way and work into the profession. So it can also lead to study elsewhere. People might do this one-year course and decide, as did some of the students from last year, they've gone overseas. Because musical theatre is something that is, of course, a worldwide language. We've been fortunate enough to just come back from Beijing, China, where we were asked to deliver a musical theatre program. And it's astonishing and extraordinary to us that the language of musical theatre is a worldwide one. And the West End and Broadway are such huge markets for musical theatre that some students decide to go over and pursue their careers over there. Ladies and gentlemen, we don't have much time for more questions. I will be returning at the end of the talk on the Bachelor of Fine Arts Acting, and I'm very happy to answer more questions on this diploma course. Then we probably have time for one more question. Is anyone burning with a question? No, Anna's saying no, there's no time. Well, again, thank you for coming. And again, a round of applause for our performers, our students.
Thank you very much, Mark and students. Okay, everybody, welcome back, and thank you for joining us at NIDA's Open Day. The next session we have coming up is about the Bachelor of Fine Arts in Acting. Just before we get to that, because there's a lot of new people in the auditorium, I'd just like to remind you we're filming and photographing this session. If you don't want to be filmed or photographed, I'll just need to ask you to move to the back of the auditorium. Thank you. Now, of course, once you're finished with this session, we do have a lot going on today. If you want, you can take a look at our facilities with the backstage tour. They leave every half an hour from the foyer near the big lamp installation. And if you do want to see a NIDA student production coming up next month, we have tickets for the Olympians, which will be in this theatre, and it's a great example of what NIDA does. And they're on sale for $18 today from the box office. And of course, all schedules are listed in your schedule events, which you should have a copy of by now. Now I'd like to welcome to the stage John Bashford, the Head of Acting, Katerina Moraitis, Head of Voice, Andrew Ross, Head of Music, and Gavin Robbins, Head of Music, to talk to you about the Bachelor of Fine Arts in Acting. Oh, and also we have Dai Ju, Head of Screen. Thank you.
Welcome to NIDA. My name is John Bashford. I'm the head of acting at NIDA, and I'd like to introduce you to my colleagues. Katerina Moraitis is head of voice, Andrew Ross, head of music, Gavin Robbins, head of movement, and Dai Ju, head of screen. What we're going to do with you this morning is we're going to have an overview of the course, the structure, how we train the actors here, career options, leading up to the end of the discussion where we will outline the audition process, and then hopefully we'll be able to take some questions from you. And I think you already know the form. There's a microphone down on the left-hand side of the auditorium, so if you make your way there at the Q&A time, you can ask your questions. So to start with, NIDA offers a Bachelor of Fine Arts in Acting. This is a higher education course, and it is unique. It is particularly tailored to the Australian industry, but it draws on a very wide tradition of conservatoire training. The basis of the training is a full-time, three-year training. And when we say full-time, we're talking about 40 plus hours of contact per week in these facilities. So the training is delivered through the mechanism of four disciplines: acting, movement, music, and voice. And the process of delivering these classes, which are generally taught in the morning, so disciplines are taught in the morning, what happens is that they are then put into practice, we hope, in the afternoon through individual scene study, play production, etc. The most important thing to bear in mind is that the work is embodied learning. It's kinesthetic. You learn by doing. It's not about sitting down and reading a book, although reading a book will help. It's actually experiential learning, and all my colleagues here believe passionately in the value of the doing. The answer for the actor in training is very often found in the doing. It's about engaging the body, the mind, the spirit, if you like, in a collective ensemble, discovering their own voice, their artistry, and through working as individuals within a group, they will acquire skills that will enable them to become the best artists that they can within the period that they are with us, and hopefully that will lead on to a longer-term lifelong learning. So part of the training is going to be collaborative. You will work with your peers, you will work with students from other disciplines and other courses at NIDA, and part of it will be self-directed. You have to be self-starters. You need to be able to be motivated to complete tasks that will be set. There is a rigor in the training, and it's not for the faint-hearted, I would say. So why do we train like this? I think the most important thing to bear in mind is that actually this way of training comes from there are historical perspectives, and it's the idea that we try to teach a holistic way of approaching the work that involves us in the use of four particular disciplines and bringing those disciplines together in terms of practice. So, your journey at NIDA over the 3 years. We start off with year one, and in this year, the focus is really on the individual. You, the artist, finding your voice. The most important thing is to find out who you are. How does your body work? How does your mind work? How do you respond to the stimulus that a play or a scene or your fellow actor, student, what sort of response do you have to them? The most important thing within this process is to combine reflection, so observation of yourself and others, and bring that work to the rehearsal room. There is a process whereby we start the work very simply, dealing with the self, so that students will work on a monologue which speaks to them and their cultural heritage or identity. It's very, very important that we actually recognise that Australia is an incredibly diverse country and we have many communities, and our student body is drawn from all those communities. And so part of that journey, part of the most important aspect of the training, is to recognise that your specific individual voice is valuable because it is representative of Australia at large. And by recognising who you are and where you come from, we believe that you can actually then become the better artist, because then it allows you to engage and transform and explore other ideas, other cultures, other forms of theatre making. So, using the monologue as a starting point, through the training, you will move into scene production. You'll work on an act, and then at the end of your first year in training, you will eventually produce a complete play, or an hour and a half version of a play. The aim being to gradually expand the muscularity of the actor, the stamina, the capacity to engage with more and more work at a more and more detailed level. This takes you into the second year. In the second year, what we are exploring really is the idea of the actor moving towards the other, moving into more difficult and challenging areas of work, such as heightened language and text. So, for instance, you may do Shakespeare restoration plays, you may look at some Chekhov, American plays, and of course, an introduction into screen in a way that is going to challenge your perception of yourself. There are two production seasons, and the production seasons are an opportunity for the students to work with other colleagues in NIDA, so costumiers, designers, technical theatre and stage management students all come together to create public productions that can be seen in any one of the five venues that NIDA has at its disposal. In your second year, there is an opportunity to work on studio electives. And when we get to the next slide, I may ask my colleagues to speak about their particular electives to give you an idea as to how they work. And that takes you through, at the end of your second year, to a point where you're ready to enter into your final year. The final year really is about professional preparation. It's about the ability, about you moving yourself and positioning yourself ready to enter into the industry. And the process involves, again, classwork, particular projects, and public productions. And as you can see from the slide, there are opportunities for you to produce a showreel. So that may have a screen element, as well as a voice reel, which will deal with voiceover skills. There will be showcases. We have a showcase unplugged at the start of the academic year, which is really designed for casting directors and agents to come along and get an appreciation of where these young actors are, looking at contemporary naturalistic scenes, which helps the agents understand, that actor could be cast in a contemporary play or film or television series. And then towards the end of the year, we have a showcase which is going to change this year, but the aim of that particular piece of work is to try and celebrate the diversity of ability and qualities that these actors have. So we're looking at a broader range of material being shown on that showcase to the agents, to casting directors and industry professionals. So, how do we do this? We work through a variety of core disciplines. As I said earlier, we have acting studio electives. At the moment, there are three electives. These occur in the second year of each training, and they give the student an opportunity to spend approximately 100 hours drilling down into an area of interest for them. So at the moment, the offering is an elective in movement theatre, in music theatre, in applied theatre, which is theatre that is engaging with communities and helping groups discover their own voice, working in perhaps prisons, in schools, etc. And next year, we're going to add a new elective, which will be a classical acting for the contemporary stage. So I may ask my colleagues to speak a little bit about the their current offer.
Hello. So I'm going to talk a little bit about the movement elective. So ultimately, the students are involved in a more intensive experience, drilling deeper into movement training. So all of the actors, no matter what elective that you choose, you're going to do a lot of movement training, a lot of vocal training, music, and you will cover a lot of it. But it gives us an opportunity to work with a smaller group of people that have maybe identified an area that of expertise that they want to refine. But it's interesting because there's some people that have come from more of an intellectual background and think, well, actually, I've never really had an opportunity to go and push my physical instrument as far as I can. So what we'll do is we'll work with elements of acrobatic theatre. We'll be able to work a little bit further with elements of contemporary dance and applying dance and storytelling. You can probably see in the atrium, we have quite a lot of aerial facilities here, and so we prepare the actor to do aerial work. And this obviously has application to film, to theatre, to large-scale events, ceremonies, but it also requires incredible body control. So it tends to refine the artist's ability to have a more dexterous instrument on stage and on screen. It does, I think, what's exciting is it gives us an opportunity to collaborate. We're doing works with the City of Sydney, we're working with other theatre companies at the moment, and I think in the face of the dreadful funding cuts that have just happened, I feel more NIDA has this incredible responsibility and opportunity to be generating a new work and creating a lab-style environment to work with motion capture, with University of New South Wales, applying the live body into an immersive filmic experience. And so we're using, I think, increasingly, it's an opportunity for the actors training here to articulate an aesthetic and an artistic vision that they can develop and take into the industry and maybe actually create the seed of a brilliant show that they might have a work. And we're working on a street theatre piece at the moment. So there's lots of opportunities, I think, for the actors to generate, as John's talking about, generate their own work as artists, but be working at the forefront of new physical and technical skill. So it's a real, I think it's the only place in the Southern Hemisphere that offers that kind of elective in terms of visual and physical performance. So it's a real honour to run it.
And Andrew, would you like to speak about the music theatre?
Yes, as John, both John and Gavin have said, the synthesis of skills is something that we're intensely interested in NIDA. And as Gavin was just talking about new works, and one of the things that we did last year was created a new work, a new musical, which was presented here on this stage, which the slide you might have seen a minute ago with somebody in aerial in a long black flowing dress was from that. It was a new piece directed by Craig Islett, a new score by Iota. Gavin supervised all of the aerial work. So music theatre, I suppose, coming to the elective, as Gavin said, even in the classes, generally in the acting course, you will do music and singing throughout the 3 years. But we did see the opportunity to then, as we've said, dig down into another skill. Now, some people might come in with a very high level of music theatre ability and then decide not to do that, but to, as Gavin said, expand into the physical world or the classical world. So just because you have a skill in one particular area, yes, we would love to have you, I'd love to have people with great skills come into my music elective, but don't feel you have to when you come in. On the other hand, you may be somebody who hasn't done music theatre before, but it might open an acting door for you. And I suppose that's one of the things I'm interested in, is how music can become a trigger or another entry point for actors. I believe that music, that everybody can sing. I'm one of those optimists. But I really do believe that, everybody has a voice. They're all just different voices. And so, yeah, I'd like to encourage people to, all the way through the course, we come at singing through acting. And we try to do that in the music theatre elective as well.
Great. Just looking further down the list, we have acting, interdisciplinary collaboration. And really what we're talking about there is the ability for the actor to recognise and be part of the wider community that creates a piece of work. We are collaborative artists. We will not succeed on our own. And I think one of the brilliant things about NIDA is the ethos of us working together collaboratively to create the best possible work that we can. So though that particular line refers really to the production seasons that occur for the second year actors and the third year actors. But it also segues nicely into performance and ideas. Performance and ideas is the area where we exercise the brain and we need to support the plays that we're doing. And how we do that is through research. We encourage our students to engage with the thematic ideas of the play. We want to know something about the history. Where do these plays come from? What are the worlds and the ideas that were current at the time of writing? How do they impact upon us now, perhaps, under a 21st century Australian sky? And so the performance and ideas feeds the intellectual life of the actor, helps encourage the skills of those actors to go and become inquiring artists, which is an essential part of the training. The introduction to collaboration and student-led projects are led by our colleagues Chris Hay and Robin Dixon. And Chris and Robin develop both the performance and ideas, but they also take us into the, lead the students in their student-led projects and collaborative works. And in these instances, what we do is we are encouraging students to work in small groups, to respond to the world around them through their observation, and to develop small imaginative pieces of work that can be viewed and shared amongst the community here at NIDA. What is exciting about this particular idea is that what we're trying to foster is confidence, that young people can make work and make it happen. And very often, because of where they are in their lives and their facility with modern technology and so on and so forth, we get astonishingly responsive pieces of work that challenge perhaps more traditional forms of theatre making. And in a way, those particular projects are the seeds that we hope will help take our young artists into the future to become the future theatre makers, film actors, etc., as they move forward. The last line on this particular slide refers to professional practice, and this is the way in which we try to engage the students with the actuality of entering into industry. So, for instance, you will have sessions that will connect you to how do you set up a company? How do you deal with the ethical issues of working with communities and dealing with their stories? How can we deal with contracts? How do we deal with negotiation? How do we respond to the cultural environment, et cetera, et cetera? So that there's a program of work that is run throughout the final year that will aid the actor and help them to acquire skills and knowledge that will, again, take them into industry. Di, would you like to talk a little about screen and the role of screen within the training?
A little? Yeah.
Or a lot.
Screen is a kind of new part of NIDA's history and chapter, and began here in full study in 2010 in the facility you can see up here, which is the Reg Grundy studio. And I just want to acknowledge Reg Grundy, who passed away just in the last week at the age of 92. His marvellous legacy is to us is the space, which is now converted into a fully professional soundstage. So all the teaching in screen is integrated training alongside my colleagues and the training that they do in their classwork, and comes as part of, as John said, the afternoon sessions around screen training, using all of the skills that are being taught and absorbed in the morning sessions over the full 3 years of your BFA journey. So screen is, again, very much practice-led study. And as you can probably see there, all those people who are doing cameras and sound and all the other work are the acting students. My view is that you learn about screen by doing the other work so you can understand where you sit in the mechanism of the world of screen. And it is also an exploration of all of the elements of your training as you go on. The reflection of screen over 3 years is the same pathway as John's just described, and that is that in the first year of training, it's very much about self, and the work you do in screen is your own creations of work. Second year leads to the study of pieces of text and greater narrative, and then by third year it is a fully professional environment, and finally showreel is supported by a fully professional crew, and the actor is now stepping out of their other roles and primarily pursuing their craft of a screen actor. And the last thing I need to say is really important to me is that screen acting is no different to anything else. It's rather like Andrew's view, the actor is the actor, all I do is guide the actor in their craft skill around the journey they're on. A good actor is a good actor in either place.
Thank you. So, career options, here we go. Stage, TV, film, radio, voiceover artists. You will do all of these things. The most important thing is not to limit yourself as an actor. You may be lucky enough to be doing a voiceover for an advert in the morning, heading down to a rehearsal room for the middle of the day, rehearsing a play, and then performing in the evening. Or you'll be getting taken off to a location to shoot a film. And so really and truly what we're after in terms of the training that we're offering at NIDA is giving actors the tools to work in any environment so that they can pursue the careers that they want. All of the careers that come their way, which may be a slightly different thing. We are interested in theatre makers, of course. We're passionate about that. And we really are thinking about how the industry is changing. There is a sense in which, you know, there are funding cuts. There are no guarantees that money will be around. However, as artists, if you can be creative, if you can work with people, you can generate your own work. And I think one of the things that's very key to our whole view, a holistic view of what the training can be, is this idea that as collaborative artists, you can make, you can be the companies, you can make pieces for the future, and you even though you may be doing other forms of work in between the job you love, those times where you are being most creative, you may be generating your own pieces of work, you have the capacity and the confidence to believe that you can do that. And of course, you will have met your peers and your fellow artists in this building and elsewhere. So here are some we prepared earlier. I was here back in 1985 on the PG Dip Director's Course. So in the building at the time was Baz Luhrmann doing his final year as an actor, and Richard Roxburgh, I think, was in the year below him. It was quite nice for me coming back to Australia in January and to pick up a flyer, and Jeanette Cronin was doing a piece of work out in Newtown. Andrea Moore, who was also a contemporary on the acting course, is teaching up in Queensland. So the idea that the people that work in this building go on, have careers in a variety of forms across various media and platform, that's all up for grabs. And what we hope is that this list will be added to by future generations, perhaps some of you who are sitting here this morning. So, we come full circle. if we go to the outcome, which is careers and so forth, what we need to do is think about how do you get in. And that may be a little bit of the... there may be some interest in that. We have a very simple process, but we hope it's one that will be inspiring to you as actors. Preparation. Basically, what we ask you to do is come prepared. Choose two pieces of work. Have a third up your sleeve. The information about those particular pieces, one of which is a contemporary piece, one of which is a classical piece, and the third piece, there are some developments on the course, so the information about that third piece will appear on the website, I think, around the 1st of July. But what we want you to do is come prepared. Come prepared with pieces that you like, that you enjoy working on. There's no point in working on a piece of text or a speech that you don't enjoy. It's not going to show you to your best. From our point of view, what will happen on the day is that groups of students, applicants attend. We put you in groups, and our students who help us to help manage the day will lead you in a warm-up. That is part of their training. So sometimes the members of the team here will be giving them a gentle prod or a suggestion that perhaps they need to add an element to the workshop warm-up. The aim here is for the student to lead the group, get them warm, prepared, and at ease. From our point of view, we want you to do your best. We want you to be in the best possible place to show yourselves and your work to us. We want you to be ready, confident, and able. So by having a warm-up, by loosening, by working together, we hope to sort of alleviate some of the nerves and the tension. Then what will happen is you will be asked to share your pieces. And we treat the audition process rather like a workshop. What we're quite interested in doing is seeing how you can adapt. So we may say to you, can you try it like this? Or we may give you a few ideas and say, could you do it again like that? Or we may ask you to improvise it in a different way. Part of this is about how can you adapt within the circumstances of you know, the workshop. Can you take on a note? And also about exploring the possibility of play. It's very, very important, you know, the ability to let go of something that you've been working on and embrace perhaps change, the unexpected, something that you're not familiar with. So having shown your pieces, there's a process whereby we are sifting. We are looking for, I suppose, a balanced and an interesting group and a range of abilities. And what we will do is we will ask some people to stay or come back for a recall. And to others, we will say thank you for sharing your work at this moment in time. Gradually, over a process of a number of these days, we will have accumulated a group of students who will come back for a recall. The recall day normally occurs at the end of any block of time, depending on which city we're in. And at the recall, a similar process will happen, but what will be different is that there will be a full panel. So we will have representatives from the disciplines of movement, music, acting and singing, and voice. And usually it is us, as heads of department. What we need to do is see those students that we've asked to come back for a recall. And again, there is a process of sharing your material. You will be asked to show your third piece, and then there may be some workshopping and further examination of the work in the afternoon. So there's a constant process of workshopping and sifting, and eventually, by the end of a day, we may have a number of candidates that we want to take forward to our shortlist. So at that point, we will ask you to be prepared to be videoed, and we will video one of your pieces. We will often ask you which one you prefer, but sometimes we will have seen something in one of the pieces of work that you've done, and we'll actually say, can we have you do that particular piece, and we will film you. Now, having gone around the country, having visited every state, we come back to Sydney for selection day. And on selection day, what we do is we view all the work from the shortlisted candidates. There are usually between 50 to 60 candidates at that point. And through discussion, through viewing of the video material, we come down to a short list of students and a list of students that we offer. We operate, in principle, 50-50 environment in terms of men and women coming to NIDA, and so our lists will reflect that. So that's basically what we do in terms of the selection process. I think I've probably gone on long enough, and it would probably be much more interesting for you to fire some questions at us and to see if we can help provide you with some answers. So I'd just like to say thank you to some of the team who've been supporting us here. Phoebe, our stage manager, David, our production manager, Dylan doing technical wizardry up the back, and Anna is down on my right, auditorium left, with a microphone. So if any of you have questions you wish to ask, please make your way down there, and one or other of us will answer. Thank you.
And just a reminder, if you do have some questions, if you're watching the stream online, you can use the NIDA Open Day hashtag on Twitter. Or if you're in the upper levels of the theatre and can't get down, you can use that as well.
Hello. In regards to the BFA, because you guys have a new elective, a fourth one, do you guys plan on extending the intake of your classes along with that addition of the elective?
No. No, unfortunately. The elective is to add to or complement the current offering, but we still will only have a student body of 24.
Okay. Yeah. Thank you.
Okay.
I'm a mother. Can I just ask you the ratio of students that get in straight from school?
It varies year to year. This year's first year intake, we have 5 who have come straight out of school. Some years we have none. I can't remember when we have had a... No, sorry, I've lost it. What was the question?
How many students get straight in from HSC?
Yeah, this year 5, but it varies. We only take on talent, on ability, on who's ready.
And to follow that on then, those students that don't get in first time, yep. I presume you must get a certain amount that get in second, third, fourth time or whatever.
Certainly. One of the people who is actually out on the desk at the moment, Dane, and he's been proudly telling everybody he got in on his 5th try. Mm-hmm. And it's true. We take people when they're ready. If somebody's auditioned before, we have all of their notes from their previous auditions, and as we go through, we see where the growth has been.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah. Thank you. Hi, how you going? I'm Rob. As far as extracurricular or extra time really goes for actors, people who are attending NIDA, is there any opportunity for more than just the course to participate in for the students?
Can you clarify what you mean by that?
You've got the whole course laid out for us here and everything that would happen, are there opportunities, for instance, for actors to, or any student really, to participate in helping the other students get their work done in the makeup area or the properties or... Yeah, that sort of thing.
I think, in a nutshell, no. Partly because the demands of the course are very great, yep. And you will find yourself very, very busy. Mm. You will work with other people from other departments through the collaborative and student-led projects. Mm. But in real terms, you will be very busy and probably tired by the end of the day. I mean, it is a very demanding course, emotionally, physically, you know, spiritually, as it were, and it will make demands on you. And the day runs from in some instances, 8:30 in the morning till 6 at night, most instances, with breaks, obviously. So it's a busy time.
Okay. Yeah. Thank you.
Hello, I'm Alexandra Rigby. I have a question about the audition day, particularly when you have the students as the warm bodies. What do you feel should be the limitation of the performer's interaction with them? If that makes sense.
If somebody's acting with
yeah,
you,
yeah, yeah.
How much do they participate in the audition?
They, you know, ultimately there's a lot of active listening going on. I mean, there can be moments, depending on the audition, where we might ask the NIDA student to improvise with the auditionee. So there is, you know, depending on how the audition's going, there can be quite a bit of interaction, actually, you know. And as you're well aware, great acting is often about listening and receiving information. And so, therefore, we get to see you responding authentically to another actor, one of our NIDA actors often, that might, you know, give you a response to some of the improvisational text that you're working with, you know. So be prepared for anything, I'd say.
All right, thank you.
Hello, my name's Lisa. And I was worried this would be a silly question, but I think everyone kind of wants to know here. So on the audition day, when you're watching thousands, pretty much, of monologues, what particular characteristic are you looking for to jump out at you and make you think, oh, yep, that's someone we want? So aside from the obvious things, if that makes sense.
It's a great question, and it's an impossible one to answer. And what I mean by that is that there is no one thing. I think one of the keys to auditioning is this: be yourself. Don't try and second guess our want, our need. What we're looking for are individuals who we think can receive a training, are open enough to respond to what we have to offer. I think in terms of what we watch on the floor, the good thing is that there are individual aesthetics from all members of the team. We will gravitate and respond to different things, and so having a variety of people there means that we are interested in different elements. So you can't predict what we're interested in. All I would say is be yourself, be open to the moment, offer yourself, you know, and your work. And that's probably the best way to do it.
Okay. Thank you.
Oh, hello. Following on from the question about the school leavers, do you encourage students to apply for both the bachelor courses and the diploma courses? Is that a good plan for them to follow? Like, does one alternate one against the other? Or?
Testing. Oh, it works. Good. Yes, I'm happy to jump in there. Look, I think the courses are very different in nature, but I think it's always good to keep your options open. I think some people really benefit from one-year training, and it really helps them focus their need and develop their skill. And you know, obviously, quite a lot can happen in that time. If you're unsure as to whether you're right already or indeed are hungry for 3 years versus 1 year, I would say audition for both, definitely. I would say always keep your options open. Come and meet the staff that are leading those auditions and interviews, because it's an opportunity for you as well to meet more NIDA people, see if it's the kind of place that you want to be at for 1 year or 3 years. And definitely, you know, the different staff members may be looking for slightly different things depending on, you know, how the cohort for each year might be looking. So yes is the answer, I think. Do both.
Hi, I have just two quick questions. The first one's with an audition process. How much of one's experience sort of judges whether someone gets in? So obviously if someone has had a lot of experience in the field, do they sort of slightly get more brownie points in getting into the audition process?
No. No, not necessarily. Sometimes life experience is more interesting rather than technical experience. Does that make sense?
Yes, absolutely.
Because there are greater resources to draw on. So it's not necessarily a given that, you know, a lot of experience will help. It can be an assistance, but also some bad habits may have been picked up on the way.
Okay, thank you. And the last question was, in the acting course, how much does one get to, I guess, dabble in a little bit of directing, a little bit of maybe story writing, or a little bit of, like, producing? How much do they get to sort of dabble in a little of those fields?
Really and truly through the student-led projects and the collaborative projects. So that's, I mean, I think in a way that's a really great opportunity for other areas of interest to be explored. Mm. So those sort of things are possible within the context of those projects.
Thank you.
Hi, thanks for the talk. If during the term, once you've been accepted, you were cast in a film, is there any leeway to sort of take a short hiatus and do that, or what would happen?
In principle, no. No, I mean, I would say once you commit to the training, commit to the training. If you've got a career on the boil, go and follow the career, in all honesty, because it's with a training like this, there's an accumulation of skill. And it's rather like, I suppose, if you want to be a pianist, you've got to practice your scales, and then you may end up playing Chopin. But if you don't practice your scales, it's just black dots on a page. And I think in a training environment, it's the accumulation, constant practice, and constant execution of the disciplines that will take you through the training. The minute you step out for a film, say, 6-week shoot, what happens is it disrupts your training, because you'll miss 6 weeks of work, but also it disrupts the group. And from our point of view, in terms of how we train, we're fervent believers in the ensemble, i.e. a group of people working together collectively. So I would say there won't be leeway. Does that make sense?
Yeah, thanks very much.
No worries.
Hi again, and I just want to say that my name's Siobhan. Forgot to mention that.
Hello, Siobhan.
With the the diploma and the BFA, would you say that the diploma is more accepting of school leavers than the BFA? And if the school leavers in the BFA, the school leavers who audition for the BFA aren't successful in proceeding in the audition process, would you recommend that they do something like another uni course? And what uni course would that be? Or would you leave that to their life experience choices and all of that?
Mark, do you want to answer the first?
Just in relation to the diploma course, absolutely. Firstly, let me say everybody's experience is different, as has already been said. Mm. Everyone's life experience, everyone at 17 or 18 or 19 or 20 is, you know, completely unique individual. But certainly with the diploma courses, we are happier to consider slightly younger people because we do see them as foundation level courses. We see them as a very logical step for people who have passion and interest and skill all through their school life and are leaving school and are going, you know, how do I advance my journey into the performing arts further? So we're happy probably to look at people with a little less experience maybe than the BFA courses, although as we've heard, sometimes is absolutely the case, people are ready straight from school. The NIDA's new course, the Diploma of Stage and Screen Performance that we're offering for the first time next year, is very much aimed at school leavers and very much aimed at people who are still deciding which aspect of the performing arts most suits them, even though the focus is on performance. There are opportunities for writing, directing, designing, that kind of thing. So we're very keen to advance people's individual passion and hunger for that kind of training, absolutely.
The uni question.
And if you don't get in, what I recommend is doing workshops, like actually going and doing classes, do voice classes, do improvisation classes, do, you know, physical training, dance classes. Work, there's so many elements to the craft that you can actually be actively addressing those elements of your training in that year, as well as living and experiencing, you know, life. Yeah.
And see as much as you can, read as much as you can, and get your head out of screens. There's a world outside you. And as an actor, you need your powers of observation. The little screen in front of you is denying you that. Put it away. get on buses if you don't get on buses. Get on trains if you don't ride the train. Look at people around you. You need to be engaged with the wider world. And all of that will feed your choices as an artist. Does that make sense? So through life, I would say, yeah, you know, draw on the experience around you. Do the classes, move yourself forward as an artist so that you're ready for the next year or perhaps the year after or the year after that, as it may be.
And as it turns out, and it is an option to you in certain circumstances, but each of the diploma courses that we ran last year, there is a student in each of those courses that is now in a BFA course. So for some people, it's very much a pathway into further training. And some people have then chosen to do further training at other universities as well. And yet others have chosen to make their way into the profession. So it becomes a personal choice, I think, how you spend your time and how you go about advancing yourself in the area that you're interested in. But certainly the diploma courses, to go back to your question, for some people will be a pathway into further training somewhere or here.
Okay. Thank you.
Hey, Rob again. How you going? I assume there's a lot of people in the room who are already thinking about preparing, and if not, cool. given that a lot of the context of preparation doesn't get released to us until about July 1st, there are people right now who are pretty hungry to get started if they haven't already. What would you say to those people about how to prepare specifically, and does NIDA have any Saturday morning classes that they can go to until then, you know, that sort of thing? The end.
First of all, apologies for my brain explosion. I've got a bulging disc and it sort of grabbed me at that very minute before. Anybody who's had one will know what that pain's like. Yes, the Open Program has many courses that you can come in and do. As far as preparation at this stage, I would say just be reading plays, reading monologues, finding stuff, so that when the time comes to make some decisions, you've got a variety of things rather than just choosing something because you've only got a couple of weeks to get ready.
And I'd just like to add to that, that it's very useful to choose something that you relate to and that is around your age range, because often applicants will choose something that is above and beyond their understanding or life experience. So think about what it is that speaks to you personally, rather than a piece of text that you like because you like the images or something like that. Choose something that you feel you can speak from yourself. Because really, in the end as well, we're looking, can you use the text and language in a way that makes it your own? And can you then let that go, whatever you've prepared, so that we can play on the floor with you and move you in a direction? In other words, can you be directed? Are you directable? So you can only do that really when you have something that you understand from a personal perspective. So think about that when you choose your pieces.
And don't make it too hard for yourself. Don't try and be too clever. Don't try and choose something that's got a really thick Dublin accent or something, because the chances are the first thing we're going to do in the audition is say, can you please just drop the accent, because we're not really getting you.
Rock on. Thank you.
Hello. What's the most important idea that you would like a student who's trained for 3 years at NIDA to take away when they're in the industry regarding arts culture in this country?
I think my response to that would be that they're an open collaborator that has the ability to synthesize a sense of holism. And we're very good in the West at breaking down elements of our training, you know, and we have to, in a sense, train voice and movement and singing and things like this individually. But what we do as much as we can is we try to cross-reference the terminologies that we're using in the acting and in the voice and in the movement and the musicality of the actor, so that those things are becoming one. And it's important, I think, that as we move forward, as a country and as a nation in terms of our artistry, that we're being able to flex our creative muscles, but our ideas. And in a sense, this course here is giving people a range of classical training, but the ability to have time to distill new ideas and reflections about our country and about ourselves as a nation, and then forge new work. So I think to have a synthesis of skills, to be a collaborator, and to be creating new film, new theatre for that's poignant and entertaining.
Hello, I'm Ruby. As a current Year 12 student completing the HSC in drama, what advice would you give to us school students in their individual and their group project work?
I was just going to say voice. I think one of the things, I've worked with a lot of drama students in my time, and one of the things when I work with them I discover is that they fail to look at what the text and the language is doing. And what we often teach here at NIDA, along with the interdisciplinary approach to acting, voice and movement, is how we come to the text and then how we take the text off the page and give it to an audience. So it's not so much about being real. Let go of being real and think about what the text and language is doing and how that is directing you. What is the thought on the page? How are you breathing into the text and the language? How are you gesturing and moving the text and language? That would be my advice, is think about the text, the language, and what that wants from you and is asking from you.
Hi guys, I'm Jamie. I just have a quick question. If someone has been subject to bad publicity in the past, since NIDA is such a high-end institution, could that hinder their chances of getting it through to the process of the course or the audition process?
I would hope not. In all honesty, I would hope not. You come as an individual, or anybody comes as an individual, and we are engaging with that individual in the moment in the audition process. So that's our first point of contact. And then what we need to do is work with the individual. If should they get further down that path, we work with the individual. Yeah. People change. Things happen, you know?
I also think that one of the... There's a couple of things about training for 3 years, and one of them is that you have the chance as an artist and as a human being to reinvent yourself in a way, away from the public eye. If you have been in the public eye before, it gives you the opportunity to develop and change.
Thank you so much.
I am Gary, and my question is regarding the different disciplines. So when you come in for an audition, is it like a one audition fits all? You know, if I want to go for the 1 year or I want to go for the 3 year, do I have to have a different procedure or setup for that?
Look, absolutely, fundamentally, yes. If you're interested in a 1 year diploma, then you indicate that, you go through the processes on the website, and then a certain number of people see you in relation to that course. And if you're interested in the 3 year degree courses, then you go through that process. So you would, if you're interested in, as I said, keeping your options open and being considered for different courses, you would need to audition then a couple of times.
And is it all in the same day?
No, they're on different days.
Okay.
That information goes live from the 1st of July. So if you go and look at our website after the 1st of July, we let you know where we are, in what cities we are, on what dates and what times there are. That information is there from the second half of the year. And those applications stay open, I think, till the end of September. Yeah. And then it's usually around November, December that we're meeting people and doing the auditions and interviews.
Okay, thank you very much.
Thanks, Gary.
Good afternoon. Sorry, hi, I'm Catherine. I just have a question about the auditions. In terms of meeting those who audition and watching them perform, are there any particular, emotional qualities that resonate with you as they perform? Is there anything that you search for in particular?
No. Partly because the wide variety of material that students and candidates present us with. So there is no one sort of, we were looking for this emotional quality. What we do is we respond to the choices that the candidate have made, and that will be unique, a unique combination of their response to the actual piece and their own self, as it were. So I would say what we respond to is the openness of a student and their willingness and their pursuit perhaps of
playing whatever they're doing truthfully.
And as far as choosing pieces, I would go for range and flexibility across those pieces.
Thank you.
Hi, my name's Belinda, and I was wondering what things could your students do to make you lose faith in their ability to represent you as a company, and if so, how and what do you do to go around these people?
Anybody?
Should I repeat?
Yeah.
It's a huge question. Yeah. One of the things we publish on the website are NIDA student policies. So if you're concerned about what kind of behaviour you might get up to that's inappropriate and what would, you know, disgrace you at NIDA or whatever, just have a look at our policies and see what the expected behaviour is. There's a very important one called the NIDA Code of Conduct, and it just lets you know what the expectations of NIDA are from its student body. So, you know, that's a way to inform yourself. If you're thinking, gee, I'm not so sure what the day-to-day culture of NIDA is like, then that information on the website there, the policies, will give you a little bit more information.
Okay, thank you.
Hello, my name's Eamon. I was just wondering, do you have any suggestions in terms of the preparation for the monologue to being more open with the workshopping, so like things that we can do in preparing the monologue to become more open, I guess?
I think the most important thing is your response to the work. You make some choices. So in a way, it's worth looking at, here's the monologue, where does the monologue come from in relation to the play? I would say to you, know what the play is. You know, read the play from which you're drawing your material, so that you've got a knowledge of it, and then you're bringing your interpretation to that work. Having made some choices, then what happens is leave the work alone and let it go, so that if somebody asks you to adapt or explore a different avenue, you're able to explore it. The point about any of this is the sense that actually what we're doing in a rehearsal room is we're always testing material. We're exploring in the moment our responses to the words, the language, the interaction between the other actor, you know, the other actor in the room. And so the vital thing is not to get stuck and fixed, because if you get fixed, you can't respond. And like any communication, it's got to be two-way. You know, it's got to be open, and you need to be, as an actor, available so that you can respond in the moment truthfully.
Thank you.
Okay,
we're nearly at time. We have time for one more question, but just before we do, I'll jump in with one from Twitter, if that's okay. This is from Erica. I believe she's watching from China. Is there a showcase of third-year acting students for industry members, agents, and what's the jumping-off point for graduates? Can you just quickly talk through that?
Is there a third-year showcase?
Yes. I mean, I think I outlined it earlier. There is a third-year showcase, but it actually works it will work in a slightly different way. And our engagement with the agents is cumulative. So what we are encouraging the agents to do is start their engagement with our students with the Showcase Unplugged, which is bare boards and a passion in one of our rehearsal studios, a little bit of light, some sound, and short two-hander scenes. Then there are the public productions that the students will do, so the agents will come and watch those public productions. So there's a range of plays being done here in June, July. So agents can come and watch those, see the actors. They can come back at the end of the year and see the actors in their final public productions. And at the same time, there is a showreel that is produced, so elements of screen and so forth are worked on with Di and her team. And then right at the very end, there is our final showcase, which this year we are changing the format of. We're going to explore a celebration of the work of the students, so that instead of just doing another duologue on the stage, what we're going to look at is perhaps a more holistic approach to show elements of their versatility. I think that's the most important thing, is to show how versatile our students are. So throughout the year, there are opportunities for agents to come to become familiar with the work of the students, and perhaps to have those conversations that may lead to agent representation.
Thank you. Now, just one last question. No?
No.
Okay.
Out of time, so I think we're all right. Ellie is answering it.
Okay, great. Thank you. All right, well, that wraps up that particular session. Thank you very much to the team.
Thank you.
Hello everybody and welcome back to NIDA Open Day. For those of you in the auditorium, now we have coming up the panel discussion with NIDA acting graduates. So led by Di Drew, our head of screen, we have Eamon Farren, Honey Debelle, Matthew Predny and Jess Vickers. So welcome them to the stage, thank you.
He's well trained, isn't he?
I didn't do TP, I did that.
Not good at props, clearly.
Yeah, no,
no
props.
No good at props.
Do you want to make some?
Yes, hello. It's my pleasure to introduce people who have gone through this building, survived their 3 years, and most excitingly, continue to act in their daily life, every day of their life, doing other wonderful creative and clever things, but mostly inhabiting what was their dream, which was to come to NIDA, leave and do the thing that they love practically every day of their life. That's great reward, and here they are in front of us. So from left to right, the wonderful Jessica Vickers.
Hello.
Matthew Predny.
Hello.
Honey Debelle.
Hello.
And Eamon Farren.
Hi.
So we are all agreed that the success of this session will be in your questions to us. So I'm quickly going to just let you know a little about these marvellous people. Probably throw the odd question their way, and then if you could start to think about yours and hop down to the microphone so we can guide this session about what you need to know from the people who've been where potentially I'm assuming a lot of you will be by this time, by the end of the year, which is lining up to audition to come to NIDA. I think that's probably the purpose, most important part of what we're here to do, which is to provide you with those answers. But Eamon, first of all, I'll start with you, who's recently been cast in Twin Peaks Revival, which is pretty exciting. Yes. It's an illustrious career for Eamon, and it spans wonderfully screen and theatre. Red Dog, Brilliant in Switzerland, a wonderful kind of portfolio of work. Was that the plan when you left?
There's two answers to that. Yes, if I'm lying, but no, if I'm telling the truth. Because yes, that was the dream, I guess. The plan was just to sort of survive, really. Yes. But then they kind of merge, I guess, if you stick in there and work hard enough, I think. But I essentially just wanted to be a theatre actor when I started. That's why I came to NIDA, because I went for theatrical training and I loved theatre. I did community theatre back at home and all that sort of stuff. So a film is something I discovered, because when I'm the oldest on the panel. So when back in my day, there was no television or screen acting course in my time. So that's something that's new to NIDA. So we didn't really have any grasp of that kind of technique when I graduated. But so I had to learn on the fly with, you know, auditions and stuff, because essentially when you graduate, that's a lot of what you do straight away. So that became something that I fell in love with after graduating. Mm-hmm. But it's awesome to be able to do both.
And having just received a nomination in for Carlotta, so that's testament to jump in at the deep end and come out with something as wonderfully theatrical, extreme, and at the same time recognised for translation of character. That's fabulous.
Yeah, that was an incredible production or show to work on. And also what was lovely is Jess, Murray and I went through NIDA together in the same year. So we got to like meet again a few years after and do that together. So that was like super lovely and kind of weird because we've seen each other be bad and good. So, and she was mostly good in that.
I think that's one of those marvellous things, which is that, you know, you may train together, live side by side with each other, then you go out into the industry and suddenly an alumni walks into the space and you're working with them. That must have a pretty resonant kind of place of creative security.
Yeah, absolutely. And people that went to NIDA 15 years ago and people that have just graduated, like NIDA is definitely, I mean, as are all schools, like, you know, WAPA graduates have the same feeling. It's not... NIDA isn't Robinson Crusoe in that sense, but it is lovely to, it's a lovely connection to be able to have some, like a short form way of communicating from the start. You kind of have a shared knowledge of where you've come from and what you've been through. It's different for everyone, but that is definitely a great starting point, and it feels nice and warm and fuzzy sometimes.
So, Honey, just finished Arcadia, STC.
Yes, finished that a few weeks ago.
Midsummer Night's Dream coming up. So, and early work on Anzac Girls.
Yeah.
So, again, a lovely combination of the theatre and screen side by side for you.
Yeah, absolutely, which has been, yes, I guess we've been very lucky in that way. But Anzac Girls was such a great role because it was a really, really small role, but I was on set for the whole shooting period. So it was a kind of dream first job because I... you know, didn't have a huge amount to sink my teeth into, but I also just got to watch other young actors who were a lot more experienced than I working for 3 months, which was really great.
Tell me about those first months out of graduation.
They're hard. I mean, of course they're hard because, you know, everyone says you won't work and you kind of think this little voice in the back of your head that's like, oh, but I'm the exception though. Like, I do work very hard. And, you know, and then you get out and you're like, oh, I'm not the exception. I am working at a bar every day. And that's hard, and oh. but you know, I was fortunate. I have really great representation, who are really, you know, lovely, and so you just feel like you do have a support network from NIDA, and you know that you've worked hard enough, and you have the skills, and if you're willing to stick it out, the work does start to trickle, and then sometimes it starts to flow. And some people walk out the door and into work. I wasn't one of them, but that first 6 months, I mean, I was still just so excited to be like to be out of here and to be an actor and, you know, auditioning every day and doing screen tests and working a lot as a reader, which I do quite a bit, which is great, working opposite other actors while they're auditioning. So that kind of got me through the first 6 months, I suppose.
And what was the first gig?
Carlotta. I had two lines in Carlotta with Eamon. So that'd be the first gig. And then Anzac Girls after that. Yeah.
I was in a dress when we first met, and
yeah,
so
he was,
I had
yeah.
to reintroduce myself today.
Jess, just finished Fiddler on the Roof.
Yes.
Congratulations.
Thank
for
you.
For those of you who saw it, yes. Yeah, there you go.
Thank you.
And Matthew too, so, you know, side by side again, same year and working side by side. I recall 30, what was it, number 30? Short film, best actor in... that short film festival?
Nominated.
Well, that's,
yeah.
That'll do for us. the Manhattan Short Film Festival, no doubt. So, well done.
Thank you.
And then one of those kind of amazing experiences for the working new graduate actor, which is to go on the national tour with Gruffalo's Child. Learning curve?
Oh, absolutely. You're travelling around in a very uncomfortable van. There's five of you in total, three putting on performances. You're in different theatres every day, really, and you're performing for kids. So it's one of those things where you can't really hide from anyone you're working with. You just have to make every moment count, I guess. And it definitely makes you resilient.
That decision to take that job, was that an easy one? I mean, given that we meant not being in Sydney and around doing the audition thing, was that a tricky thing?
Yeah, it was, but I really wanted that experience. And also, you do miss out on things when you book a job like that where you're touring around. You do definitely miss out. Mm-hmm. I missed out on a fair few things that came my way, and you just sort of pick it up and move on, and keep going, because you're always on that tightrope. Mm-hmm. You're always balancing what you can and can't do, and sometimes you just got to make a decision and go with it.
And I think, you know, that's one of the things that will come up, I think, in questions and certainly discussion, which is, as the actor, how much you are architect of your career and how much your career is kind of steered by the opportunity and what's around at a particular time and the choice that you make. So you can have a grand plan, but that plan may shift because of a job in front of you. Yes?
Yeah.
Matthew, Fiddler on the Roof. Mm-hmm. Avenue Q, the lead, Avenue Q, and now I think we're allowed to say Kinky Boots.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Yeah. So would you like to talk a little bit about your process of getting those roles, Matthew, and the audition process, because I understand and know that's incredibly rigorous.
Mm. Yeah, the process, I came out of acting school and I had a tough couple of months. I think almost everyone does. I finished and suddenly schedules were gone and I was just in this nebulous kind of free to do whatever I wanted space, which was really tough. I like structure in my life. A couple of months in, I got the audition for Avenue Q and I knew it was a show I really wanted. It's a dream role for me. And so I worked really hard. And it was a weird process. That one was just a single audition, a single really long audition, and from that they filmed it and they chose the entire cast out of the one experience, basically. So that one was, at one end of the spectrum, a really quick audition process. But then Kinky Boots, which I've just recently got cast in, I started auditioning August last year and finished auditioning at the end of January this year. So there was 8 separate auditions, and auditions with the Broadway team and all of the Australian producers and stuff. So it's a case-by-case basis. Every show has a different process. Sometimes they're really short, and sometimes they take most of your life. It feels like most of your life to get through.
So that's one of those areas of the actor which is, and we'll talk about this in my questions to you guys, but it is about a stamina and belief in self after 3 years of, as you say, having your days kind of prescribed for you, and then suddenly you're out. Hopefully, and in this case, in every case, with an agent there to guide you, but you're out there on your own, and then what is the day that unfolds? Eamon, I'll start with you. What advice would you give to those imminently leaving to go out into the industry for mechanisms of survival and continuing to hold belief in yourself?
Yeah. I think the biggest thing to do is just keep going, because there's nothing, no one can, no, as Honey said, it's so hard to know who's going to jump into something, and you know, you could not work for 6 months to a year after drama school. And it's a really big culture shock. It still feels like a culture shock, you know, I'm coming up to almost 10 years graduation, and it's still something that every actor deals with, no matter if you're 21 or 61. It's a very kind of hard thing to get used to, but that's part of the craft. I think what the most important thing for new graduates is to not put pressure on yourself to sort of, and this is advice that I would give myself and my peers and people that are, you know, actors I've worked with that are 55 give the advice themselves, is to not compare anything to anyone else. because it's not just your year at NIDA, you've got WAPA, you've got VCA, you've got everyone that hasn't trained at drama schools. It's a big tough industry, and you all know that already before you get there, but sometimes it's hard to remember that it's not just you, it's everyone else as well. So that is a wishy-washy answer, but I guess what I'm trying to say is there's no real hard and fast way to do it. Everyone has their own thing. I think, obviously, keep reading, keep writing, keep seeing stuff, keep being involved, because it is a muscle and you never want to lose that, you know that. And it's very easy to, but also have a break too. If you want to not do anything for 3 months, totally do that. The industry's not going anywhere. It's actually more about making sure that you're ready and you're safe and you're primed to do your best work. And I think after NIDA, you're on the go so much and you're working so much at NIDA that it's very easy to feel ready. And then the challenge when you're out is that there isn't that structure, there aren't those classes unless you find them. And so it's your job to be ready. And if that means taking some time off or doing something else or whatever in between, then do that, because your experience in life and you as yourself is what you're going to bring to a role. So that's more important than being a stress ball of not working. And don't compare yourself to other people. That was long and wishy-washy, but
sorry. No, it's good. I think that message is don't compare. It is quite destructive. Yeah, continue path. Honey, you're actually got a duality of life at the moment. Yeah. Do you want to talk about that? Because it's about sort of survival.
Which sort of ties into survival and knowing, you know yourself. Some people can have time off from work and really use that time off to replenish and set goals and focus on what's next. I can't when I'm not working or not busy. I'm a mess. So, and I knew that going out before I'd even hit that first sort of lull of not working. So while I was still in this building, I applied to study at university and do a second degree. So that's what feeds me when I'm not acting. And, you know, the jobs I get are the jobs where I have been rushing from a lecture to a rehearsal room to audition for something, and I'm sort of learning lines on the fly, and they're the jobs that I land, because for me, when I overwork something and I've got all week and I'm not doing anything except working at a bar, I work myself up, I overwork the piece, and then you don't land the job. So I say that would be my advice, is to know whether you're the kind of person who can stick it out and really take time for yourself or make your own work. I don't like writing, so for me, making my own work is kind of hard. You need to have a team, but some people can write their own stuff and make their own short films. So if you know that's you, then plan for that. But I knew that wasn't me, so I had to plan for something else. So I guess that would be one bit of advice. My other piece of advice would be, in terms of stamina, to not get bitter at the industry, because a lot of actors, when they're not working, they start to hate acting. And we're all here because we love acting. You've got to love it. And when you're not working, if you turn that not working into bitterness towards yourself or towards the industry, then it's all downhill from there. Because if you're not enjoying the audition and putting in the work, then people can sense that from you, I suppose. So I guess that would be my advice.
Advice?
Definitely find other outlets for yourself creatively. I'm on the other end of the spectrum to Honey. I write a lot. It's what I'm currently facing a couple of months of a break between contracts. So I'm just producing as much as I can, writing as much as I can, because it fills in my time. And also I think a lot of these things you learn through experience. In third year, we had a lot of talks with people and they gave us these words of advice, and they were really wonderful words of advice, but it wasn't until I got out and I experienced them for myself that I really learned what they meant. And I really learned what it meant to motivate myself and to make myself work harder, because I didn't realize it at the time. I thought I was working hard enough, but you can always work harder. And I really learned that from this, you know, first year out of school. I've really learned how much harder I can push myself. I think that's important.
Jess?
Yeah, well, just jumping on that, I think that it's really important to not necessarily just take words of advice that you get in drama school and from other people in the industry, and actually just go out there and give it a go. Actually try and fail as much as you can, gloriously. So just put yourself out there. Don't be afraid to make really bold choices, whether that be in your work or in your life in general, I'd say. But I think that making a choice to keep learning is a really important thing. It definitely was for me. And that's something that you can hear a lot, but it's not until you really get out into the industry that you really understand that that will never stop. Falling in love with learning is the biggest lesson that I learned.
Yeah, I mean, it's that pursuit of excellence which makes it a life's journey. It's never good enough. There's always something more to do, and that's what makes you your heart beat and keep going in this industry that can chew us up sometimes. So that's good advice. Why did you audition for NIDA? Why NIDA, really?
Because my drama teacher told me to. He said, have you thought about auditioning for NIDA? And I went, oh, not really. And then as I kind of got close to it, I thought, oh, you know, why not? Because I just thought there's no way I'll get in. So the best way to look at it is, it's like, I don't know how much it is now, it was like an $80 fee to audition and have some of the best teachers in the country watch you do your thing and give you notes. So I thought, that's a bargain. Like, you pay hundreds of dollars for workshops. So I thought, yeah, I'll just go along. And then I got the call saying I got in, and that's when I went, oh, am I actually ready for this? Like, did I really want to go to NIDA? And then I had to take some thinking and realise that, like, of course I wanted to be here and was very lucky to be here, so...
Drama school is always the plan for me. I am one of those nerdy kids that did drama all at school and all that stuff, and it's not nerdy, it's just cool. But I say that to say that I wasn't someone that just fell into the idea of drama school. That was what I wanted to do. And at the end of high school, I auditioned, I'm going to be completely honest, I auditioned for QUT because I thought I was from the Gold Coast, and I was like, I'm not going to Sydney, that sucks. So I just went to Brisbane. And I got to the last round, and they said that I was too young and not ready. And I was like, that's bullshit. So I went...
We were straight out of school. Was that straight out of school?
Yeah. It was a blessing, because and then I went and did economics at university. And my economics lecturer told me to audition for NIDA, so I did. I auditioned for NIDA because I wasn't going back to QUT because they said no. And I only say that because QUT did me a massive favour, because this is a different topic, but when to come to NIDA is a whole different individual question as well. For me, that year off was really good for me. And so why NIDA? Drama school was going to be the thing. NIDA, for me, was always... Actually, Anna Torv went to my high school and was like 10 years ahead of me. And she's. I think most of you know who Anna Torv is. She's a really fine actress. And she rang me and said, you know, don't go to QUT, NIDA's the only place. So NIDA was always an ideal, and I'm really glad that I ended up there.
Why NIDA?
It was kind of... I always had my sights set on acting school in some respect, and I always had my sights set on NIDA because it was... From high school, it was always the school that was talked about. It was always the pinnacle of tertiary achievement, I guess. And so I auditioned for it my first year out, and I was only 16 at the time, so I was very young. But from that, I got through the first round, and that's what inspired me, because they told me, yeah, you're too young, but they told me, come back next year, and that's kind of what gave me an extra bit of hunger for it. So up until that point, it was just like, oh, I'd really love to do that. That'd be really cool. But from that point on, it was like, okay, I've got to do this. So I started a law degree, which obviously didn't finish. So
you got in the second time?
No, I was number three.
Third time?
Yeah. So did 2 years of my law degree. And then on my third attempt, got in.
I think this is a really important thing, and we'll come to questions very shortly, but having done the audition tour for many years now, I know it came up in the earlier session, I can't emphasise enough, it's when you are ready.
Yeah.
It's not about age, it's not about experience, it's when you are ready for the 3 years that are ahead of you, and that's part of why the audition process is as rigorous as it is, and we do have people who are now in the course and they've auditioned up to 6 and 7 times. That tells us a lot about them and their determination and vision for what they want to do. And it informs the kind of actor they will ultimately be as well. So in some ways, the second and third, even fourth, fifth attempts can really help the journey that you're going to go on, because you are so clear in your destination, and it helps us guide that fire that's inside. Jess?
Yeah, I auditioned twice. Got in on my second time. Obviously, I got in and didn't have to come back the third time, but I would have kept coming back until it happened. For me, I auditioned for NIDA because I actually just wanted to do music theatre to begin with. So I auditioned for the Whopper Music Theatre course, and at that time, 2011, just coming on to 2012, the one-year music theatre course at NIDA was taken away. And I thought, okay, well, you know, this new hybrid course, which is not what it is right now, part of the BFA, but this is what Matt and I did. It was, you audition for the acting course, and if you're successful, you sing a few songs within your initial audition, and you can do the music theatre stream. So it was sort of alongside your acting degree. And I thought, oh, there's absolutely no way that I will do that, as if I would get past all those acting rounds. There's absolutely no way. So similar to Honey, I just thought, I'll give it a go. You know, I'll get great feedback. And it's a chance to perform and give things a go. I'd never read a play before in my first audition. But that was why I chose NIDA, and it always, you know, NIDA is seen as the elite, really.
Okay, here's the question, and then we'll see what comes from the floor, please. So if you're thinking questions, if you can start to make your way to the microphone. My question to each of you is, for those out there who are about to think of auditioning, what's your piece of advice for them?
Anyone can
start.
Breathe. Keep breathing. I mean that, really. Keep breathing. I get super nervous still, and you just got to breathe. Choose with your audition pieces. Choose something, or in all things, choose pieces that you think reflect yourself and the kind of work that you respond to and love and all that sort of stuff. Don't try and sort of be something. I mean, for example, my Shakespeare audition for NIDA was the Moor from Othello. You know, like, that's going to be a tough role for me to ever get. But it's because I loved what he was saying. So just really choose something that you respond to and that lights your fire, and gives the auditioners an insight into what you love, you know, and what you want to do, and be open to what you hear from them on the day, and be, again, it's just the readiness is all, you know. I can't say anything better than that. Be ready to, just be ready to do it, everything that you want to, and be ready to not do everything you plan for, and just be ready for anything. Just be open and keep breathing.
I'll jump on the end of that, because I'd say, in terms of being open, this is probably quite a weird tip, but someone said it to me once and I found it really helpful. Watch everybody else and be generous with everybody else. If you're sitting on the floor going over your lines and in your head and not watching and taking in, there is so much creative energy in that room when you're auditioning. So just be really generous with other actors. I don't know if you still do improv in the audition process. It's so important. If you've been sitting there preparing to do your piece with your head down, and you get through to the next round and you're doing improv, and all of a sudden there's somebody on the other side of you and you don't have any lines, and all you have is being present and listening. It's just, yeah, really important. And you know, not that the judges are watching you while you're watching, but just, it's just important to show that you are generous. But yeah, it is just, you should be, you know, you'll learn just as much. And when I was at NIDA, I learned just as much from watching my fellow actors work and be critiqued as I did from being critiqued myself. So I would just say, keep your eyes open for everything.
Yeah, and along the lines of being open, be completely flexible and open for direction, because that's one of the most important things that not only you'll learn in the audition process, but in the 3 years that you're studying and then coming out into the industry. Your job is to tell a story, and if somebody is seeing you, a director is seeing you, and they have a certain idea of a way that they can tell the story better, then it's your job to adapt to that and to be able to be flexible. So if one of the panel gives you something to try, then run with it 110%. Don't just, just change it, 20%. Go all out, give absolutely everything you can.
Can I jump in? Do you want to hear a horror story about my audition? Mm-hmm. I did Helena's monologue from Midsummer Night's Dream, which is hilarious because I had to do it again for my audition. I know, Lo, she is one of this Confederacy. It's probably still on the list of ones to do. And I did it, and it's a comedy, but I was 17 and a girl and very hormonal, and so I was really really angsty about it. It was a very emotional piece for me. I was like, oh, Helena's on this journey. And Tony watched it and he said, darling, it's a comedy. And I went, yeah. And he said, where are they? And I said, in Athens. They're going to the forest in Athens. He says, I want you to do it in a Greek accent. I was like, what do you mean a Greek accent? He said, like a Greek Australian, like fully six subwoofer. I want you to do the whole thing like that. I was like, are you right now? No time to prepare. He said, go. And I just had to do it. So in terms of being open for anything, be open for anything.
Jess.
Yeah, well, I'll just jump off the back of that. Also use it as a chance to perform, enjoy it. Sometimes you can look at the audition panel and put them on a pedestal and all these people around you who you think are judging you, but realistically they're just sitting there going, I'll have to get up in 5 minutes and do that as well. And, no one's really judging. And just use it as a chance to perform. I tell myself that going into auditions now.
Everyone wants you to do well. They're there to help you do well and put your best foot forward.
I mean, that's true for us when we're auditioning. We want you to get in. We're not there to try and get you out. We want you in. So, that's a really important thing to keep in the back of your mind. Nobody's there trying to test you to see where you're going to fail or falter so we can go, oh, you're gone. We want to have you here. So, keep that in mind, please. Yes, great. Questions? Have we got some people down there for some questions? Marvellous.
Hey, I'm back. How you going? Hi. I'm Rob. I'm sure there's a few people who have graduated and they've got degrees and bachelors and diplomas and investing a lot of time in something. I, for one, when I graduated, had a few regrets. I wish I could have gone back to orientation day, Rob, and just said, stick at this a little bit longer, or really open yourself up to this, or just don't sleep as much, whatever. Do you have any of those for yourselves?
Yeah, I'll jump on that. I think most of my learning, it sounds absurd, but most of my learning happened in retrospect. So whether it was at the end of first year or the end of second year or even at the end of the degree in my first year out, when I was in the middle of it, I couldn't see the forest for the trees, is that the saying? Yeah, I was so stuck in the middle of everything that while I was learning and I was developing, I just felt so overwhelmed sometimes that I wasn't noticing the changes. But then when you get out and you see it all from a distance, all these things click. And I looked back and went, I don't necessarily regret anything, but I looked back and went, I get it now. I understand all of those things that I was learning, even though it didn't feel like I was learning them at the time. Yeah.
Anybody else? Anything on that?
I think, did you study at NIDA, or are you talking about another bachelor?
No, I studied game design like an
idiot. Oh, okay, cool. Yeah, right. No, great. I think the only thing I want to say is that this course is a process, and I think, I haven't studied any. My only bachelor is in NIDA or whatever, but I went to, economics and shit out, as I said. But I think it's a mistake. It makes don't ever feel regret about that stuff, especially with an acting course and a theatrical course. There's so much to learn here, technically, but anyone that ever says that they went to drama school and it was like the perfect kind of version or run through, or they were their ultimate selves the whole time, is lying. Because it genuinely is a real process, and a slow one or a quick one. It's really individualistic, but
it's really a course that opens you up, and you're learning technical skills that you will learn, that you will use throughout your acting career. But also, it's a really personal journey for you as yourself. And this place will kick your ass too. I mean, you know, you won't be able to sleep in or whatever, but as long as you're open, and I think it's good that you had that experience really before that, because then you come ready to sort of be something else in another kind of very different to game design, you know? So I don't think anyone will regret things that they did at drama school.
Yeah.
They could do things differently, but it's such a process of opening up that it's not the same kind of experience, I would say, as a normal uni degree. Yeah.
And I think just to finish off on that, the training you will find is a life's learning. So what you do in the 3 years, you carry through the rest of your career. And I can certainly vouch for the number of emails from people I've got years later in New York or London or somewhere going, oh, I get it. Yeah. I get it. Yeah, what you said totally. The first year, I get it now. Totally. So it won't happen at the time. It will unfold. Thanks. Let's have the next question. Thank you.
Hi, yeah, I was just wondering, a big part about the NIDA course here is the ensemble aspect of it, and we all know how with acting it can be quite self-absorbed. So how do you deal, or is it challenging to work in ensemble with other actors and listen and respond?
Yep. Oh, I'll go again. Yep. In first year, the idea of an ensemble was really drilled into us from very early on. I'm not sure if it happens with every year, but it was almost every class we were doing for the first term or two, we were told, you know, that we maybe weren't gelling in a certain way, or we needed to work together better. And so it was always at the forefront of our mind. And yeah, I think you learn. Yeah, I don't feel like we were a particularly self-absorbed year. I think we grew into a really close-knit people, and there were people that you're closer with and people that you're not as close with. But I think part of doing an acting degree is learning to work with other people, because you have to spend, you know, 6 days a week with these people for 3 years, and it's you've got to find ways of coping with that.
And then, just jumping off that, in the industry, sometimes you have to do 8 shows a week with a cast that you have potentially just met a month ago. So learning those skills is really invaluable.
And I think, you know, it is part of the training is about the ensemble, working with an ensemble, because, you know, you are actors, therefore you are in a company of some kind. And ultimately, it's this ensemble here, but at the same time, it's about your journey as an actor and the skills you learn around the ensemble that you take back out to every other ensemble in which you will work. So ultimately, we are not training a company of actors.
No.
This is not what we do. We are training each of you individually, but we're training you around the notion of working within our company.
Yeah.
Is that kind of... Yes.
But it is important to acknowledge as well that there are very talented people from all over the country descending into this one class. And so, yeah, it is going to be, that exists. And it's going to be, and I think the challenge that the school puts forth to every single actor is to acknowledge your own talent or your own potential, but to also optimize your ability to work with people otherwise, because surely if you don't do that, like that's a big challenge of the 3 years, because the smart actors are the ones that can foster their own individual sort of work ethic, but also learn how to work within a group. Because when you get out there, if you can't work within a group, it's going to be a really short career.
Thank you. I can see the line's got long, so we'll move on. That's okay. So long.
Short answers.
Short answers.
Hello.
Hi, I'm Zoe. I'm not a Sydney local, so my question would be, in terms of surviving the course with living and financially and independently, how did you guys go about that, considering there's very long and big contact hours here?
The interstaters should answer that.
I wasn't interstate.
We're all from around here, except Jess and I.
Yeah, I'm from Adelaide.
Oh. Yeah.
Yeah, so I wasn't. And I, you know, I was also like straight out of school. So there was also the sort of moving out of home and learning how to do laundry and like cook pasta for myself. So yeah, good question. And it's going to be very different for everybody, because everybody, of course, comes from different backgrounds. I was not eligible for youth allowance for my first 2 years here because I wasn't independent, and that depends on your age. So I think if you're over 21, I don't know what the rules are now, but so for my first 2 years here, that meant no money from the government and not being able to work. So I was very fortunate in that my parents supported me for 2 years. And I didn't, no, I started working in my third year. I was working at a bar on weekends. Third year, it sort of gets a bit more manageable in terms of hours. I didn't have family up here either, so you do, in terms of finding a place, if you are fortunate getting in, there's a really good discussion board that opens up for the sort of new grads moving up. Often grads who are finishing, I mean, new students moving up, grads who are finishing often move out of their sort of NIDA Kensington digs and keep it within the family of NIDA grads. So, yeah, I mean, you're, in terms of like specifics, I'm sure there'll be discussion boards open. Rent, you're going to be looking to be paying, yeah, around $250
a week. There's a great Facebook site where, you know, the NIDA house moves on from one group to another. So there's that support. And I just want to say, just before your experience, I think it's really important if you do come from interstate that you find yourself in a share house environment. It's really not a great thing to try and live alone.
Yeah.
Your isolation will become even greater, yeah. And sharing with other of like mind will really give you that wind beneath your wings over the, especially in the first year, I find. Yeah. Yes.
Also, I meant to say as well, I was very lucky to have a NIDA bursary for my first 2 years here. So they are available. So do have a look on the website. There's scholarships, there's bursaries available to support students who don't get youth allowance.
Quick answer.
I worked in a video shop.
I lived in a college across the road, which was really useful for the first year because it exposed me to hundreds of people who were not doing this course. And so that was my personal outlet from the course.
Because was that at University of New South Wales?
Yeah, exactly. Great. Because when you're inside the course, you're surrounded by 20 other people who are doing exactly the same thing as you and all going through the same stuff. So it's good to have an outlet somewhere.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Good afternoon. This question is probably more aimed at the director, but being a Year 12 student and hopefully aiming to audition for NIDA, I'm constantly, you know, alluded to the stigma that you can never get in just graduating from Year 12, and obviously that's primarily based on the fact of readiness and this idea that, you know, you need to be ready, as you've said. But I was wondering, with this readiness aspect, is that more so your external character as well as your ability to act, like your ability to, you know, your EQ and all that sort of stuff. Is that just as important as your ability to act in getting into NIDA initially?
They're the same thing. What you're doing creatively is fundamentally part of who you are around the choices that you make in the audition, and as we've already said about your flexibility to absorb and inhabit the choices that are put before you. We do have people who are straight out of school who have come into NIDA, as well as people who are, you know, at the mature end of the spectrum. We've had, you know, the actor of 32 married with two children who then embarks on a study of 3 years to become an actor. So there is no generalisation around this thing. And so I think for you, just forget Year 12 and just get on with it. Do the reading, go to the theatre, read as many plays as you can, watch these guys work, watch everything to do with what's going on culturally around this passion of acting, and you bring all of that. That's what we want.
Definitely. Thank you very much.
It's not something you can prepare or create. It is, you either are or you aren't, and that's just an essence that you have. So just prepare your piece and don't worry about it.
And it's really important for us. We see what you choose to bring to the floor. That tells us a lot. And the note before about us not watching you, I tell you now, we watch you. Because we're a panel of people, not all eyes are just on that one person there. We do watch the generosity that you bring as an actor. That's as fundamentally important to the work of you as actor around the ensemble, how you share and support other, because that's what acting's about.
Definitely. Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you.
Hi. I have a question for all of you, but mainly Jessica, because you said you'd never read a play before auditioning for the first time. I was just wondering how all of you picked your pieces, your audition pieces.
Sure. My initial audition, my pieces were terrible because, because of that reason. But there was that year in between where I just read anything I could and I just immersed myself in theatre and community theatre as well. And that was wonderful. I think that really enhanced anything that could have come out of my second audition.
Yeah.
Pieces, I don't know if it's the same, but we had to do a Shakespeare monologue, contemporary. I tried to choose contrasting pieces. I tried to do something comic, something dramatic, and tried to make to show different aspects of myself within the three pieces. But I would say to choose the first two pieces that you do as the most contrasting pieces, because if you're lucky enough to get to the third round, you'll do your third monologue, but just make sure that the first two that you do, you're most confident with them.
I'm going to jump in and say two things. First of all, choose the pieces appropriate to your age range.
Mm.
Choose the pieces, as Eamon's already said, that speak to you so that you can discuss, if asked, why you chose it, what it means for you. And thirdly, really importantly, read the play. Do not go to the website and find a whole swag of monologues that you don't know who they're from or where it is, or it's written just as a monologue. That will not help you at all.
And also, if you're not inclined to read the play, ask yourself why. Do you love acting? Do you love theatre? Or do you love the idea of you being an actor and being a star? Because if you don't love reading plays, you're not going to love auditioning, and you're not going to love working, and you're really not going to love being at NIDA because you have to read a lot of plays. So if you're reluctant to do that, think about why and whether this place is really right for you.
Right. Thanks. Great question.
Hi, my name's Josie. I was just wondering, for the people who didn't get into NIDA on their first year, what did you do in that year before you auditioned again?
I think this is really important, actually. The year before I did get in was the year that I did the most theatre at that point in my life. So I just did a lot of community theatre. I'm from Newcastle, where there's a really big amateur theatre scene. So that really set me up well. I think I did something like 6 or 7 shows during that year, and just that hunger for the work was what drove me and made me work harder for the audition. Yeah.
We keep the records of your previous auditions, and so when you come back to audition again, it's really great for us to see what you have actually done in that intervening time. It's a very good question. We want to see and read that you have gone out and done more work to get yourself ready for the second time round. The person who goes off and says, oh, well, I went on a world tour. Well, the world tour is great, but we'd love to know that you've actually done some other pursuit of other areas of the craft that you want to spend your life in. Really important for us.
And there's other colleges out there that you can learn before auditioning for NIDA. I did a course at ACTT, which was the Actors College of Theatre and Television. It was just an 8-month course, and though I believe that those skills that I learned in that 8-month period just after high school really propelled me into getting into NIDA.
Cool, thank you very much.
Thank you.
I just have a question in terms of if when you audition you are represented. Obviously it's a pretty big commitment, how you would go about managing that if you were lucky enough to get in?
Do you mean if you already had an agent?
Yeah.
When you? Oh,
I had an agent on the Gold Coast in Queensland, and when I auditioned, you have to, I mean, you can keep ties with them, like contact if you want personally, but everything, it's best to cut ties, because you're the performer you are at the beginning of NIDA and the performer you are at the end of NIDA is a very different thing. I cut ties with my agent.
That being said, though, I know, like, Ryan, I think, was with Catherine Poulton before.
Yeah,
Ryan
keep
Corr,
contact who is a, if you want.
Some people end up staying with their same agent, but you can't do acting work while you're
I just didn't want to stay with him when I finished NIDA, that's all. But give yourself that option. Yeah, if you like the person, then keep in contact, great. But if you want to move on, then you can move on at the end, you know?
Okay, cool. Thank you.
Hi, guys. I was wondering what the most difficult part of the course was for you guys.
Second year in general, I think.
Yeah.
It was, there was just something about it, and everyone says so. First year, you come in, you've got big eyes, and you're kind of on cloud nine the whole time because you're like, yeah, I'm going to NIDA. And then second year hits, and it's the shine's worn off. You got the bags under your eyes. You're just chronically tired. The work is hard. You're always there. You're always seeing the same people, and just I think just that level of shine just kind of wears down a little bit, and you start to see it for more of hard work and less of this is an amazing thing. It's still an amazing thing, but it just,
And there's more expected of you by that point as well.
Yeah.
I think I found very difficult, and a lot of people do find the voice training quite hard, not the singing training, but your spoken voice. You attach a lot of sort of your identity, and there's a lot of emotion in the way you speak and in the way you've always spoken. And it's not that NIDA really dramatically changes the way that you communicate, but it can be quite sort of confronting when you're not, I mean, I hold a lot of nervous tension in my voice as well. So when you start to feel, some classes just can be quite confronting, I suppose, and not in a, just in a sort of personal dealing with your own mess stuff. So I guess second year, technique stuff, always technique.
Can I ask what's behind that question?
Oh, just I know it's a demanding course, and I was wondering that everyone has different aspects that they find most difficult.
Yeah, great. For sure.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Hello, I'm Ben. At the end of all your three-year journeys, how did NIDA assist in getting you professional work, and how did you all pursue professional work from your graduation?
I have a very specific answer to this one. During NIDA, the director of the first show I did, which was Avenue Q, directed me throughout third year and also in my showcase at the very end of the year. And so from that, I came into the room and I had a personal relationship with this person and I had a history, so I hit the ground running. And the same thing with Fiddler on the Roof. Jess and I both worked, our final piece here was called Light in the Piazza, and it was directed by the director of Fiddler on the Roof. And so we both went into this room with a history and a certain impression already made, which meant that we hit the ground running rather than having to start from zero. And I think the connections that NIDA gives you is potentially the most incredible thing about it, because it's in the middle of Sydney, and Sydney has a great industry, and it just exposed us to all these really great people.
Yeah, I had a similar experience with Anzac Girls in that I did one audition and didn't even get a call back. It just kind of came months later. It was like, oh, hi, you got that role. I thought, that's weird. They saw me for 5 minutes, and it wasn't until I really got to know the producer on set, and Lisa said, oh, yeah, we came to your showcase, and we saw everything you did, and we, you know, there was another NIDA grad from my year, Brandon, who was also in it. She said, we saw you both in showcase, and said, yep, they'll be in something this year. And I thought, oh, my God, I had no idea they were even in the audience at showcase. I was so nervous about getting an agent. I forgot about all the other people that come and see, not just showcase, but everything you do, so...
And the pathway is that in the final year, there is a lot of work, as the previous session indicated. It's the professional year, and you spend quite a lot of time with me, particularly in screen, because you do your soundtrack, your voice reel, a show reel, which has been on the screen behind you. And that leads you to the exposure of the industry, and then thence to agent interest. And NIDA's job is to equip you as an actor to then be taken up by an agent. Then it's between you and the agent. NIDA is not part of your professional pathway. Ours is to equip you with the training, put you in the hands of an agent, and then, as I said before, you and your agent become architect of your career beyond that. In the interim, however, if you are between agent and graduation, we will always field calls, and we do often. I do every day. Somebody emails me or calls me. Can you suggest somebody for blah I'm looking for? And we will always advise around whatever the briefing is of graduates that we think could suit the bill. But we're not part of your professional employment. We are to equip you in your professional employment.
Great. Thank you.
Thanks.
Hi there, my name's Nicole. I just wanted to say thanks so much for being so real and authentic for us today. I just wanted to ask, for somebody that loves film and every aspect of it, how much training do we get behind the scenes, whether that's directing or editing or things like that?
I suppose I better answer that one, hadn't I? Okay, so as I said in the previous session, we're here to train you as actors, but by default, particularly in screen, because I insist that they all do all the jobs, camera, focus, booming, you edit your own material as well. In fact, you even write some of your own material. You do everything except direct, but I keep offering for someone to direct and nobody's taken me up yet. But basically, at the end of your 3 years of training in screen, you are quite well equipped in the fundamentals of filmmaking. So if you want to then go on and utilise, which people have done, and excitingly for me, have been doing in writing their own web series and short films and so on because of the training, that's great. But I am not, and NIDA is not here to train you as a filmmaker. You are here to be trained, particularly in the BFA, for acting as an actor. The add-on and wonderful extension of that is these added skills, but there is no specific training from that list you just asked me. But you can always come and talk to me about it.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. We're about to finish up. Last questions, that's it. Okay, here's the snapshot quick answer, please. Why do you want to be, did you want to be an actor?
Hate short answers, die. Because I wanted to tell stories.
That's mine too.
That's
my one.
That's not just it, but essentially it is that.
If you love stories, and I love reading, and I mean, I'm sure a lot of you love film, but I have always loved books, and so to be able to all of a sudden be in another world and be on stage and telling stories is, if you don't love stories, then you're not going to love being an actor.
Because it's an industry of extremes. Extreme lows when, you know, you're in between jobs and you're like, I'll never work again. And then extreme highs when something comes through. And I think there's an addiction to that adrenaline that you feel. And it really is. It's unlike any other job, I think.
Jess?
I'd say all of the above. And also, this is slightly off topic and this is going to be a long answer, but I was we were doing our final show the other night on Sunday night of Fiddler on the Roof, and we were bowing and everyone was clapping, and I thought who actually gets clapped after a day at work? who gets an applause after, you know?
And you do it for those magic moments when you're taking a curtain call and you're like, oh, this is everything I wanted it to be. You do have the total ups and the total downs as well.
So somebody's already said it in the space today, which is, and I'll put it back to say, thank you all for your generosity and allowing us to be part of that journey. I think it probably, from my point of view, every time I sit with either those I've taught or colleagues that I've worked with, I'm always overwhelmed by the generosity of the NIDA actor. And throughout my career, the audition process, screen test of any NIDA actor has always been a delight. And so I thank you very much for your generosity and the sharing back, because in this sharing comes the new wave of actors back into the building. So thank you all.
Di. Okay, thank you very much, Di, Eamon, Honey, Matthew, and Jess. It's great, thank you. Well, that wraps up our sessions in this theatre for today. If you'd like any further information, there's plenty of NIDA staff and students out in the foyer that you can chat to. And by now, hopefully, you've got a copy of the 2017 course guide, which has most of the information in it. Otherwise, it's on the website at nida.edu.au. And the stream will be made available on the website shortly as well. Don't forget, you can also take a look around our facilities with the backstage tour, and they depart regularly from the info desk out there. Thanks for coming to NIDA today, and we look forward to seeing you again soon. Thank you.